Wftda Division One playoffs here in Columbia, South Carolina. My name is Sasha Kim. Deal with it, Morgan. I am here with the lovely Beatrix, and you can call this the main event. You can call it the gold medal game. You can call it what you want. We're going to call it Rose City Wheels of Justice going up against the Denver Mile High Club.
And it's going to be an exciting game,
oh,
isn't it?
Oh, my goodness. It absolutely will. Both teams have had very exciting gameplay throughout the entire course of this tournament.
Yeah.
On top of that, you've got to think the most important factor, obviously, in the gold medal game is the factor of the bye. You're playing for the bye. You're playing for Friday off at Champs. But thinking about this from the home base perspective, Rose City playing for not only the bye, but the chance to get an extra night in your own bed, resting up, getting ready for the competition. That is crucial.
Yeah, and for any skater that's ever traveled to a tournament or even a game, that idea of being able to spend tournament night in your own bed is incredibly seductive.
It really is, and Denver looking to play the spoiler here. They already got one big upset on the weekend when they took out Jacksonville and sent them into the third place game, looking to take home their win over Rose City if they can get it and get that first round bye.
Yeah, exactly. I just can't wait for this to start, but I know we're going to run through the officials first of all. That's right, isn't it?
That is correct. Our skating officials for this game will be Eric Rock, Laddie, William Mollis, Julia Seizure, Judge Double Wapner, and Tara Bang You're Dead, Wicked Pizza, and our alt is Vanilla Vice.
And I think it's really important to say, as we have done all weekend, is we want to know your thoughts on this game.
Absolutely.
We want to know how you're feeling about it, what you're seeing out there on the track, as well as what we're calling, because, you know, you get the same view we do. So make sure you use that hashtag #talk2WFTDA.
And first place gold medal games have been any indication, that hashtag is going to be quite busy, everybody.
I can't wait.
Make sure you send your tweets now.
So, Denver Roller Derby, obviously they played last night. It was you and I on that call, Jacksonville. We saw Denver with those two massive scoring jams, the 30 and the 32, that weren't due to a power jam at all.
I think that was the absolute turning point in the game when Denver got those two jams in. It felt like the spirit sort of rushed out of Jacksonville, and Denver was able to move along. Although Jacksonville did threaten in the second half, Denver was able to get a nice recovery, able to get that win. Rose City did something very similar to Atlanta as well.
Yeah. And also, I think we talked last night as well that Scald Eagle on the regular gets a 40-point jam. Well, she did this weekend, certainly.
Yep, against Columbia, she
but
did.
But that's usually an anomaly, isn't it? So the fact that Denver did that was absolutely fantastic and bodes well for this game as well. Clearly working on that defense from their blockers. So it's going to be interesting to see how they match up against Rose City.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go down to the floor
for this championship game. Make some noise for Denver Roller Derby's Mile High Club. Let's meet the Mile High Club for tonight. Starting out, skater number 20, Wilhelm. Skater number 22, Guypin. Skater number 28, Barrett. Skater number 3, Angel. Skater number 33, Klein. Skater number 37, Garten. Skater 398, Goings. Skater number 4, Davidson. Number 55 is Susie Powell. Skater 831, S.H. Long. Number 91 is Watson Cerebo. Skater 93, Curtis. Number 98 is Thorns. And number 99, Acres. Ladies and gentlemen, make some noise for Denver Roller Derby's Mile High Club.
ladies and gentlemen, to give it up for your defending WFTDA champion, Rose City Rollers, Wheels of Justice! Number one, Frisky Biscuits! Number 127, Jessica Chestnut! Number 155, Bella Constrictor! Number 26, Sarah Gaither! Number 260, Envy Adams! Number 28, Alicia Nisbet Smith! Number 4, Jess Rivas! Number 401, Tarantula! Number 415, Hannah Jennings! Number 50, Scald Eagle! Number 523, Liquor and Split! Number 77, Lauren Mutch! Number 8, Braun Swanson! And number 82, Quigley! Give it up for the Rose City Rollers, Wheels of Justice!
All right, that is the Wheels of Justice. Thank you to Professor Lou Bottomy and PR Mageddon for the introductions of our two teams.
Well, you know, I had chills watching those skate outs.
I just realized that was probably the first time you've seen that entrance in person before.
It really, really was. And I've come over a little bit emotional. Don't worry, I'll get over it. It's fine.
It's okay. Well, we've got about 60 minutes to figure out what the heck is about to go on. Rose City versus Denver. Winner gets the first round bye. Loser will have to go through the first round at the WFTDA Championships in just a few weeks.
Okay, well, I mean, let's get things kicked off. Standing at the Fast Girl Skate start line is number 20 for Denver, and that is Will Elm, joined by 77 Lauren Mutch for Rose City.
Rose City starting with two blockers on the line, Akers splitting that up. We're waiting for the first jam whistle to sound. Tarantula is on the left-hand side, bracing Alicia Nesbitt-Smith as we get ready to come off the line. And Lauren Mutch runs to the outside there, trying to get a nice jump on Denver's Mile High Club. Braun Swanson having to bridge back to help out her team as Wilhelm is going to get through on the inside lane. Lead jammer status going to Denver. Lauren Mutch still trapped in the pack now as Braun Swanson bridging back. Now moving up to try and help out as Wilhelm coming into the back. Going up against Alicia Nesbitt-Smith and Tarantula. Braun Swanson dropping back here as Wilhelm gets bowled over in the process, and we have a down skater. Yep, we're back up here.
Just taking a moment, I think, to reset at the end of that jam. Denver coming out so strong, so quickly. I wonder if Rose City were expecting that. Although yesterday against Jacksonville, we saw the same sort of showing at the first start.
Yeah, I think Denver's going straight for the gut in this one here as Akers able to recover from sort of having Wilhelm crashing on top of her there. We're already in the midst of a physical game.
Just one jam in.
I know, no kidding here. As Klein going up against Scald Eagle off the Fast Girl Skate start line. That is S.H. Long reaching around to try and create a lane for Klein. It ended up leaving a giant lane open for Scald Eagle. She doesn't even need that big of a lane. She's lead jammer for Rose City.
And Scald Eagle, of course, crowd favorite here. The arena erupting with cheers as she does pick up that lead, and also she comes around and picks up those 5 points for Rose.
Klein got out of the pack on a star stash now as Hannah Jennings dredging up to keep her pack in play as Skull Eagle jumps the apex, picking up an additional 4 points for Rose City.
I feel it was more like she took flight on that apex,
you
to be honest.
You could indeed
there,
say that, yes.
S1 helmets. Did you know that in addition to helmets, S1 now makes pads for roller derby too? Make S1 part of your uniform.
Next jam getting lined up here on the Fast Girl Skate start line is Quigley will be in the box for Rose City. It is Guypen jamming against Liquor and Split as Guypen trying to find her way through, gets blocked up by Tarantula Alicia Nesbitt Smith. Now working her way into the middle as Sarah Gaither joins in with the brace. Akers came up to the front to try and create a little bit of a lane, now helping out Guypen. As right now, Licker and Split still trapped behind Davidson and Garten. And Guypen able to get through on the outside lane. Lead jammer status going to Denver.
I'm really interested to see Guypen in this game following on from that Jacksonville one last night, because she does create her own spaces in that pack, and this just proves it once again here, coming in for her initial scoring pass.
Well, she committed a high block in the process. Sometimes that physicality comes with consequences, as now Licker and Split is out, eligible to score, and we will go the full 2 minutes. Licker and Split now slowly approaching here, looking for the right lane for her to take. Gets past Akers on the outside and Goings on the inside. It's completed scoring pass for 5 points for Rose City. Thorns is trapped behind all four Rose City blockers, effectively creating a runt in the background. So Denver can't exactly peel back, but Akers with a great hit, forcing the recycle into turn number three. Licker and Split now coming back in. Akers with another huge hit to cause a recycle, and now dropping back as well as Goings. Penalty is over for Guypen. She is now back on the track, back on her first scoring pass. Licker and Split on her second scoring pass, tried to break through the wall there, got downed in the process as Guypen completes the scoring pass for four. Akers now tying up Licker and Split around turn number one. Out of play warning forces them to let it go, as Licker and Split will complete the scoring pass for five. Guypen getting recycled on the inside lane. Now coming back in is Licker and Split for her third scoring pass. Akers and Goings, along with Thorns, trying to keep her constrained as the jam times out Beatrix.
A really grinding jam there for Guypen, but not so much for the Rose City players or blockers. They were really, really focused on their task at hand. They've not let those first couple of jams unsettle them. They've just eased themselves into it, and straight away you could feel how much training goes into getting to playoffs, and obviously with the eye on getting to champs.
I mean, you don't become the world champions for nothing here, as Rose City taking advantage of the 14-7 jam. Now we're moving into jam number four as Curtis jamming against Lauren Mutch. Lauren Mutch being recycled by S.H. Long right off the bat here, as Curtis trying to find a lane on the inside, blocked up by Hannah Jennings as well as number 127, Jessica Chestnut, now getting completely trapped up in the pack. Jess Rivas coming along to help things out.
S.H. Long all over Mutch, but unfortunately picks up a penalty and goes to sit in that penalty box, meaning Mutch has got a chance now to get on through and pick up lead.
Pack advantage favoring Rose City here off that penalty, as Mutch now trying to work her way through. Jennings keep bridging back to keep her pack in play, and Lauren Mutch gets through on the outside lane. Lead jammer for Rose City. Denver jumping back to try and create some offense and get a hole for Curtis.
But once again, nearly 40 seconds to call lead jammer. And Barrett trying to make sure that the lead jammer status, which went so much, doesn't cost them too much.
Well, a high block penalty is going to be called on Barrett to send her to the penalty box. As once again, Rose City on a 4-on-3 pack advantage. Curtis still trapped in the pack as Mutch almost untouched through there. Another 5 points for Rose.
Yeah, Sasha, there was very little challenge from the Denver blockers in that pass. This time, though, a little bit more difficult. S.H. Long back on track and in play, and Eye of the Tiger once again on Mutch, drawing her back as she recycled out.
Curtis had completed the scoring pass, forcing the call off. Hannah Jennings created a nice little lane there that then got shut down by S.H. Long to try and get Lauren Mutch frozen.
Rydell Skates, the innovative leader in the roller skating industry for over 70 years. You can check them out at rydellskates.com. So let's just check in on the scores. It is a 35 to Rose City, 9 to Denver. Of course, if you've just joined us and you're perhaps completely new to roller derby, Rose City are in the purple and Denver playing in the white.
Scald Eagle jamming against Wilhelm, coming off of the fast girl skate start line. Scald Eagle able to split apart the Denver two wall, able to gain lead for Rose City as Wilhelm now trying to work her way in, gets knocked to the inside there. Braun Swanson holding her back as Scald Eagle creating her own offense, bowling over Akers in the process, and she will lose lead in the process. A forearm penalty will send Scald Eagle to the penalty box. We're going to go the full 2 minutes. Power jam Denver.
Yeah, I think Scald was so focused on making sure her feet were in bounds, not creating any penalties there, that just that forearms came through. She flailed a little bit and, of course, picks up this penalty. Not great for Scald. Not a great place for her to be.
Nice little push by Barrett as Wilhelm came through to give her jammer a little bit of extra momentum as Akers holding back Envy Adams. And complete drill there by Tarantula to bring Wilhelm all the way to the back. Wilhelm now starting this pass all over again. Whatever point she's earned, they're staying with her, but she's going to have to basically complete it all over again as Scald Eagle is out. And Wilhelm found a hole on the inside that Scald Eagle also took. Both jammers will pick up five for their first scoring pass. 41 seconds left to go on the jam.
Scald Eagle just coming in with that slight glancing blow, and Wilhelm didn't really connect, but enough to kind of make Wilhelm take a little bit of a move to the side and screw off a bit of her speed.
Only two blockers on the pack for Denver as Bron Swanson disrupted the wall to get Scald Eagle through on the second scoring pass. Now the third one is completed as Wilhelm has also completed a pass. 14-9 in the jam so far. Both jammers approaching the back of the pack with 15 seconds left to go.
Bron Swanson came in with some great offense then to come and break up the Denver three wall up front. It means that Scald Eagle gets on through, picks up a further 5 points as Wilhelm still at the back of that pack, grinding away, trying to find spaces.
Scald Eagle with a big attempt at an apex jump. She will get points for it in the process. 2 points to complete both scoring passes, Beatrix.
So when you need to roll quick, think quick. Quick bearings where precision meets performance.
Rose City 20-11 jam in their favor as Denver has been bleeding blockers left and right. Denver's going to have to get control of their blocker penalties if they're going to stay in this game, Beatrix.
Yeah, but we are only in jam five right now. Still a little bit of time there to settle in, and blockers only on a couple of one penalty each in Denver. So I'm not feeling too concerned for them right now.
Klein taking the inside lane. Lead jammer status going to Denver. Nice awareness there to see the lane open and get through it. Is Licker in split now, trying to get through herself and force a potential call-up. But Klein coming into the back of the pack, running into Quigley and Hannah Jennings. Jess Rivas now coming back to help as well. And a brace now set up by Chestnut.
And Sasha, you know, it's that clarity of where those spaces are in the midst of all this chaos that makes you a great player for roller derby. Because if you can't see those spaces at speed, under pressure, you're going to really, really struggle, even with the help of your pack.
Sound call off there by the Denver jammer is 3 points picked up. Next jam getting lined up here.
So let's check out who is on the fast girl skate start line. For Denver, it is Guypin and number 22. And for Rose City, it's Frisky Biscuits, number one.
Frisky Biscuits coming to Rose City at the start of the year from Santa Cruz. Now on the charter here and making one heck of an impact in her first jam of the game. Trying to get around Akers, rides the hip through. Lead jammer status going to Frisky Biscuits in Rose City.
So Rose City, all by one jam, have picked up lead every time so far. That's what I'm right in thinking.
That I believe you are correct here. As Frisky Biscuits calling off the jam as Guype and Stash a star to get out. Only 4 points will be picked up there by Rose.
So 59 plays, 23, 19 minutes left. And you need to check out the new Radar Halo wheel. Achieve world-class edging without sacrificing grip. Two blockers, one apiece for each team, sat in that penalty box as we're about to get underway here. And it is number 93, Curtis, jamming for Denver against Lauren Much, number 77 for Rose.
And Goings, the blocker in the box for Denver, just exited. So Denver going back to full strength as Curtis comes around the outside. Lead jammer status going to her. Chestnut tried to chase her down to get her fed back into the pack. Much finds an outside lane as Curtis, lead jammer for Denver, now approaching the back on her first scoring pass. Goes to the outside lane. Checks to see where Lauren Much is on the track, calling off the jam. And that's going to be 3 points picked up by the Mile High Club.
Yeah, Much pretty much took the same line as Denver's jammer. Denver just didn't shut that door after she'd got on through.
Yeah,
so
if you give Lauren Much maybe 1 or 2 seconds to get through that same lane, she's going to get through it, and she's going to get through it quick.
So Scald Eagle. I was gonna look for a number, but it's Scald Eagle, number 50. Like anybody doesn't know that. And 20 Willem for Denver Roller Derby on that start line.
Scald Eagle looking to get her way through on the inside, breaking up the two wall, got around Thorns to gain lead jammer status now as Wilhelm getting recycled back has stashed the star for Denver. Scald Eagle now approaching on the back on the right-hand side through the outside, 5 points picked up for Scald Eagle.
And once again, pretty much unopposed by Denver's blockers. Are they just looking to spring their jammer free from the pack and grab some points if they possibly can?
Scald Eagle bursts through the wall. That is going to be an additional 5 points picked up for Rose City as the star has been passed to Akers now. As Rose City setting up a brace in the back, Akers trying a little jammer defense, not quite able to do so. And Braun Swanson created basically a one-woman lane for Scald Eagle to get through. Akers burst through that same lane, but the damage has been done so far. 15 points picked up, and Scald Eagle is not calling the jam. Akers got in and picked up 4 points for Denver.
Yeah, I feel like Braun Swanson's kind of the wingman for Scald Eagle because she just floats up front near the defenses of Denver, and the moment that Scald Eagle's ready, Braun Swanson's there to just start messing with that defensive wall, start breaking up that pack.
Perhaps they have that psychic link that sisters seem to have.
Maybe.
Scald Eagle and Braun Swanson, for like the six of you who didn't know out there, are siblings.
Powerdyne's changed the game again.
So is sisters playing roller derby.
With the newly redesigned Arias Platinum. Arias Platinum, performance redefined.
19-4 jam in. Jam number 9 coming into 10 is Licker and Split going up against Klein. Klein with a 2-all to beat on the outside, now being braced by Jess Rivas as the brace switched now to Hannah Jennings as Chestnut trying to work her way through. Goings trying to split that brace apart. Has moved Rivas to the back. Hop over the apex. Lead jammer status to Denver and Klein.
Beautiful work by Klein there. Perfectly landed and also brilliantly timed. Just as she was starting to tire of the wall herself, she knew she had a way out.
Quickly going to the box for a back block penalty as the star has been passed to Rivas. Klein calling off the jam very, very quickly there. Once she saw Rivas approaching, 3 points picked up by Denver.
Yep, so the score as it stands right now, Rose City 78, Denver 33, 15 minutes left of this first half. And you know, I wonder if you're breathing out there, because I certainly feel like I'm holding my breath watching this amazing game. Do tell us, hashtag talk the number 2, WFTDA. Let us know your thoughts on this game.
And worst case scenario, if you're not breathing, we'll do some breathing exercises around halftime. We'll be good.
Thought you were going to say we'll do some CPR, and I was no, not long distance.
It's going to be very difficult here. And speaking of difficult, Guypen now running up against that Rose City brace, but Akers with a huge assist there, creating a lane to get Guypen through as Frisky Biscuits also taking the inside lane left open. Guypen lead jammer for Denver with an opportunity to pick up points and potentially call it before Frisky Biscuits approaches. As Frisky Biscuits coming to the back, Guypen with great awareness there calling off the jam, but no points scored on either side.
Yeah, Guypen making it very clear that she was calling off that jam to all the referees and officials involved.
No, it's not like a hummingbird flap, it's a big white eagle flap.
888 helmets, pads, wrist guards. They've got you covered. Check out 888.com. So Denver taking 3 out of the 4 lead jammer statuses in the last 4 jams.
And they can swing that momentum at any point so long as they can, you know, maintain that lead jammer status. If they can prevent Rose from scoring points by calling off the jam, they can get their way back into this here. As Curtis going up against Lauren Much. Both teams are operating at full strength here. It's a big hit by Chestnut, flooring Curtis, who pops back up. Jennings now bracing the Rose City wall along with Quigley. Chestnut getting moved out of the way by Goings, but Rivas takes her spot in the brace as Curtis rides the outside lane. Lead jammer status going to Denver as Jennings tried one more hit to get Curtis reabsorbed. And Lauren Much is going to the penalty box. For a backlock penalty, it's a power jam, Denver.
Yeah, you know, Much has picked up 68% of the lead jammers this entire weekend over her gameplay, obviously. And it's 33% in this game. So sitting in the penalty box right now must be a little bit frustrated. Understatement of the year.
So now Curtis with the opportunity here as Denver switching to play a little bit of offense. Rivas called out for a penalty. He's going to give the pack advantage to Denver's. Chestnut with a big hit to send back Curtis, as Hannah Jennings pulling her back on the recycle as well, Quigley bridging to keep Hannah Jennings in play.
Yeah, Rose City just burning the clock here as Lauren Much was standing in that penalty box, now back on track and in play for Rose City, and unopposed once again passes through that pack, completes her initial pass.
I wouldn't necessarily say unopposed, as she got pinballed past the blockers. Curtis calling off the jam before Much can approach, as 5 points will be picked up here for Denver. 78-38 Rose City with the lead, 12 and a half minutes left to go in our first period.
Rose City with the lead, but they have been held scoreless in the last three jams by Denver, as they've been slowly chipping away at that differential in front of them. 38 plays 78, as you said, 40 points, that's all. 12 and a half minutes left of this first half. What a game to be watching.
Pack advantage is going to favor Denver here, as Quigley and Rivas sitting in the penalty box. Scald Eagle saying, I don't need a pack advantage, I'm just going to hop this here apex. But no, she did need the pack advantage. She cut the track in the process. And Wilhelm now with a huge opportunity. Rivas coming out of the box to rejoin the action. Too late to stop Wilhelm as Denver with a power jam.
So second jammer penalty for Scald Eagle. Second jammer penalty in a row for Rose City, and Denver sure to take advantage of it. Yep, last four jams now, Denver have been putting points on the board.
Wilhelm trying to work her way through to pick up some additional points. When Scald Eagle comes out of the box, she will be back on her initial pass because she cut before she left the engagement zone to complete the initial. So now Quigley went back to the box for a track cut. That's her fourth, as Wilhelm approaching the inside lane here gets knocked to the outside by a combination of Rivas and Nesbitt Smith. As Scald Eagle star stashed her way through, completed the initial. Wilhelm calling off the jam before any further damage can be done. Waiting to see how many points Wilhelm will get on the second pass, as a timeout is going to be taken. And it's going to be taken by Rose City, and Adam Skates team timeout.
It is an Atom Skates team timeout. Atom Skates just got a lot more colorful. Color Falcon plates and color Q4 boots. Check out all the colorful new goods from Atom Skates by popping along to atomskates.com.
So Denver picked up three on that last scoring pass, making it 78-46. Clock frozen at 11 minutes and 3 seconds. And Beatrix, I think you will agree with me, that's a smart timeout by Rose City.
Yeah, absolutely. Denver on that golden run, picking up points all along. I think the last five jams they've picked up points and holding Rose City scoreless. So a great strategic timeout called by Rose City. They need to refocus as well. I feel like a little bit they've just gone a little bit loose in that pack.
Wonky, perhaps, would be another one.
What would you use? Wonky?
Wonky. I think that'd be a good description here. Another thing, too, the timeout will also get Quigley the ability to kind of calm down at the bench. She's picked up four penalties thus far. This, again, in addition to pausing the momentum for Denver, gets Quigley opportunity to take a bit of a mental break.
Yeah, and you know, we all need that sometimes. Rose, though, with three jammer penalties so far to Denver's one. Doesn't matter so much right now, but as we move into that second half and the pressure's building, it's not a great place to be already.
They can add up really, really quick, as Klein going against Licker and Split. Klein trying to take the outside lane, moving to the inside, running up against the brace, as Engel trying to wedge herself in to get some space for Klein. Inside lane shut down by Chestnut. And looking on the outside here, waiting to see what happened, as Quigley was on the out, but
for a moment there, I thought Rose City's jammer picked up a penalty.
I thought that happened too. So Licker and Split stopped for a brief moment, thinking she had a penalty. She is now lead, as Klein going on to the back here. And Klein is going to be called for a multiplayer block. It is going to be a power jam for Rose City.
So absolutely not what Denver were wanting right at this moment. Rose City do have the blocker sitting in the penalty box, Jessica Chestnut, and this is the first lead in five jams for Rose that they've got lead jammer, so they are going to capitalize absolutely, aren't they?
Yeah, well, right now only one blocker to beat in SH Long, but that's easier said than done, as SH Long knocks Licker and Split to the outside, or inside, and Licker calls off the jam.
Well, you know, Fast Girl Skates are proud to sponsor the 2016 WFTDA Tournament MVPs. They're also 9 years dedicated to making a faster you. Check them out at fastgirlskates.com.
9 points were picked up there for Rose City as the Power Jam will carry over into the next jam. Klein will be coming out of the box here in about 15 seconds or so as Lauren Much with the Power Jam opportunity for Rose. Akers trying to create some create a nice little blockage there to get Much trapped behind. Now it's Garten and Davidson looking to hold things up. Akers rejoining the action as a bridge going back if with Thorns. Klein is out. Rose City with a double brace holding back Klein.
You know, did you catch that smart little jump that Davidson did over the apex just to be at the front of the pack as Rose's jammer came through?
Much got held up long enough for Klein to get a little bit of space on the outside. Lead jammer status going to Denver as Much still trapped behind that brace, trying to find her way through Klein now on her scoring pass, trying to get past that combination of Gaither, Tarantula, and Chestnut. Really, really pushing to try and find a way through as Akers now sweeps through and takes out Gaither. Much will get through on the inside lane just barely as Klein recycled back. Tarantula on her way to the box for the first penalty as Klein calling off the jam with 5 points picked up. Tarantula's penalty at Beatrix is a low block.
Well, it all happened in that jam, didn't it? And excited. I'll just catch my breath for
that
a second.
That is the best statement I think I've heard. It all happened.
It all happened. Everything went on, and you explained it perfectly. Well done. What I thought was really interesting there was Davidson's play in that part. Yeah. Just doing that smart little apex jump, having that awareness. Well, hang on, I'm not going to be able to get the jammer from this angle, but yeah, if I jump, I'm going to be able to pick her up as she comes through that pack. Absolutely fantastic, and really helped Denver out.
Yeah, those blocks. Her apex jumps are really becoming an in vogue thing here as Guypen able to break up the brace. She is lead jammer. Scald Eagle trapped here as SH Long with the knockout. Oh, Scald Eagle nearly cut Barrett in the process. Now Guypen trying to take the outside lane as a hole getting opened up there. Barrett trying to get a lane through with to get Gaither out as Guypen calling off the jam as Scald Eagle approaching.
You know, and second lead jam in a row once again for Denver. And as we saw yesterday, when they get those runs of lead, it really does boost up their confidence. And you see it on track and you see it in the play. It all becomes a little bit more sassy, a little bit more, a little less conservative.
Yeah.
And it flows through, right?
When you have those opportunities, you really can't play conservative. As Rose City 87, Denver 55. 6.5 minutes left to go here. We come into jam number 17 of the first half. Frisky Biscuits going up against Curtis. Curtis taking the outside lane, gets shut down by Envy Adams as Ron Swanson now trying to close out the outside. Frisky Biscuits through, she's lead, but almost getting fed back in now. Curtis has removed the helmet cover.
You know, this is opportunity for Rose as they have been held scoreless in 6 of the last 7 jams. So Frisky Biscuits with an opportunity to get some points on the board and try and increase that gap, which she's doing right now.
She's already got her hips past Garten as Davidson trying to keep her pinned down as well as Thorns. Akers having to bridge back to keep her pack in play as a penalty called on a Denver blocker. That's Thorns on her way to the box as Frisky Biscuits picking up a 5 points for Rose.
Yeah, and those blocker penalties at that crucial point when you're bracing and when you've got somebody peeled off, it's really difficult because you are going to have to dismantle your three-wall. You're going to have to dismantle that tripod, and that's the opportunity that Rose were waiting for.
There was a great effort there by Davidson after Frisky Biscuits completed the scoring pass to try and get things through as Curtis almost hit into the crowd, basically. 44 seconds left to go here in jam number 17. Jam still ongoing because Curtis is still on the initial. And Frisky Biscuits with 2 to beat in the front, trying to work her way around. She does so with a spin move to get past Davidson.
You know, these packs so stretched out over the track, reaching from turn 3 to turn 4.
Low block penalty is going to be called, and it's called on Curtis. It is going to be a Power Jam Rose City, who has already put 15 up on the scoreboard.
So that jam comes to an end. And let's just recap on the scores. Rose City reaching the 100 mark now, 102 to Denver's 55.
An official review is being taken here by Denver. Can't say I blame them there. I think we have to assume that official review is going to be to challenge the low block penalty.
Well, you know, it's the last game of the weekend. Let's make lots of assumptions. So
why not?
This official review is, of course, sponsored by Atom Skates. Now I want to tell you about a new product coming out in October. It is the new Savant Wheel, lighter, faster, and grippier. Four hardnesses for your best combos ever. Hashtag Atom Skates.
So just so everybody knows in the job description, assume at all times is in there.
Oh, yes, of course. Assume and postulate. That's what they ask you to do, and then they allow you to speak on a microphone.
So, Rock right now having a conversation with the coaches from Denver and Rose City.
You know, I do feel thankful that they don't do a math test as part of the announcement.
Nobody would survive.
Some would. So, I mean, 102 plays 55. I would normally feel like, oh, this is like might be a little bit insurmountable for Denver, but... It's not. It's not in this game at all.
No,
the
not at
speed
all.
At which Denver are able to switch from offense to defense is fantastic. We're just going to hear from Rourke right now on this official review.
Denver is contesting the low block call on their jammer.
Hey, I'm good at predicting.
No way.
It just made the most sense. It really did. So Denver looking to get the penalty overturned. Because otherwise, Rose will start on a power jam of about 28 seconds or so.
Okay, so even though Rose was held scoreless for the last six out of... let me say that correctly.
Go for it.
I'm going to try that again.
Try it in English.
I'll try it in English. It's because I was thinking in American. The translation takes time. Okay, even though Rose have been scoreless for six out of the last eight jams, the scoring is still almost even. Rose scoring 24 points, Denver with 25. So on those two jams where they did score points, they did a great job.
Yeah, and I've noticed where Rose is scoring points, they're putting up multiple scoring passes every single time, especially when they get those power jams, whereas Denver's getting those 3-0, 2-0, 4-0 kind of jams.
Yeah, and of course, and that is down to the defensive work from Rose City, just forcing those call-offs, not allowing them to feel comfortable enough to go in for that second scoring pass.
And it says a lot about the quality of the jammers, that even though this defense has been absolutely crushing, that it's still 102-55.
Yeah.
I mean, it easily could be, you know, 25-17 right now or something along those lines with the defenses that have been played.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. And I don't feel, I'm going to say this now, and I might regret it later, but I don't feel like we're going to see a blowout in this game because of that work that both Denver and Rose City are putting in.
Well, every time we think we've seen a blowout, the other team comes back. We remember last night, Denver and Jacksonville.
Yeah.
Atlanta came back against Rose City. Just in that last game, Atlanta came back against Jacksonville. So, just when you think it's over, it's not.
It's the weekend of comebacks. I imagine New Kids on the Block are going to be strolling in for the halftime show because that would just complete it, right?
As long as it's not NKOTBSB. I could have done without that, everybody. Just saying.
So, in the play that we've seen so far, Denver picking up 10 lead jammers. Rose picking up 7. They've lost lead ones. Denver's lost lead ones.
Mm-hmm.
But Denver's score, not quite the same as Rose City's just yet.
Yeah, and again, we go back to those multi-scoring pass jams for Rose City. I mean, just the last jam alone, 15 points. I don't think Denver's had one quite like that. As a decision appears to have been rendered, Rock is having a conversation now with coaches to let them know what the verdict is.
You let us know what your verdict is.
Yeah.
Use hashtag talk the number 2 WFTDA.
And by the time you tweet it out, the decision will have already been rendered and you look potentially very smart.
Yeah, exactly.
Or maybe I can tweet from the future because there's a little bit of a delay.
You know what?
I'll send a tweet real quick. Well, let's go down to Rock.
Based on the information given, it was low contact that caused the blocker to fall, separate from the initial initiation by the jammer. Therefore, the low block will stand. Denver will not retain their official review for the half.
There you have it.
Well, there you do have it, indeed. Thanks, house announcers. muscling in on our jobs. So
how dare they?
That call stands, and of course Denver lose their official review. But I still agree. I think it was worthwhile them just having that reviewed.
Because now we've got Liquor and Split out on a power jam here, Beatrix. And Denver looking at having to play exclusive defense as Rose City tried to hold. Wait a minute, an elbow penalty is going to send Liquor and Split to the penalty box. And Rose immediately falling back and rolling back. They're going to try and get Curtis to come back in around the end of turn four, but Denver not moving at all.
So Rose picking up lead and then immediately losing it. Not in the game plan, but this could work out great for Denver right now.
Curtis still eligible for lead, obviously, because she was in the box as she got through, and now she is lead for Denver. Huge opportunity for the Mile High Club as S.H. Long now on her way to the box. So maybe not as huge of an opportunity since the pack now favors Rose City.
And they have built that front three-person, four-person now, tripod, cupoid, whatever we decided to call it.
Rhombus. Rhombus is my favorite.
Rhombus. And that is a really difficult thing for Curtis to try and get through. I love the fact that she's pulled back to reset, trying to find those spaces once again.
Liquor is out. She stashed the star in the process. So Liquor did complete the initial pass here. As a back block called on Curtis is going to send her back to the penalty box. We got about 45 seconds left to go in the jam, and Curtis from turn number two having to race her way through. Liquor on her first scoring pass has completed it for 4 points. Nope, correction, 5 points here. 30 seconds left to go in the jam. Everybody standing and waiting.
Yep, and Denver with only two blockers out on track right now to try and contain Liquor and Split and, neutralize this power jam against them. I don't think they're going to be able to do that. Of course they're not. Liquor and Split through on the outside there.
Well, the important thing here for Denver is that they do have Angel and Curtis standing in the box. Angel has left and Curtis has left as well. But also Chestnut coming back out for Rose City as Liquor and Split completes the scoring pass. 5 points picked up for Rose City, 4 for Denver on those scoring passes.
You have taken our score there, Sasha. Rose City 117, Denver 59, 2.5 minutes left of this first half. And Rydell Skates lets you make your skates your own with custom-colored, handcrafted Color Lab boots by Rydell Skates. Check them out at RydellSkates.com.
And again, we go back, multiple scoring passes in that. Obviously, the jam running long due to the loss of lead on Denver's part. Mm-hmm. As Wilhelm now jamming against Scald Eagle. Barrett rejoining the action for Denver, creating a bit of a lane there for Wilhelm. As Nesbitt Smith trying to get things set up, creates a lane on the outside for Wilhelm. Scald Eagle still about to escape the pack there. Davidson trying to chase her down. Wilhelm now approaching the back of the pack. Here she comes, growing on the outside there, calling off the jam after scoring all 4 points for Denver.
Davidson and Barrett absolutely stand out for Denver at the front of that pack, holding Scald Eagle for as long as possible and really just supporting their jammer out on track to grab those 4 points. Great. 63 plays, 117. Once again, Rose City not scoring. And there's been only two jams for Denver with multiple scoring passes, whereas there's been 8 for Rose.
And that's why the score is what it is, everybody. Next jam getting lined up here. Klein going up against Lauren Much. Much with a kind of a hug running forward, I guess is the best way to call that. Arms flailing at the sides, trying to get the lane broken up here as Angel dropped back to play some offense for her team. And Much forcing the out-of-play call. She's going to be lead jammer for Rose.
Yeah, Rose completely dropping back as well and helping with that out-of-play. You know, out-of-play, out-of-track, out-of-time. They just had to let Much go.
And S.H. Long with the hit out. Barrett dropped back to force the recycle towards the jammer line. Much calling off the jam with 40 seconds left to go in the period. So we will get one more jam.
Oh, 1-2-1 plays 63. Coming towards the end of this first half. Again, just inspired pieces of play. If you're sat at home watching, you skate for a league, you're going to be sat there going, how do I do that? Well, you put your skates on and you practice.
And watch a lot of footage, too. That's helpful.
Listen to us. We will tell you how to do it.
I don't know about that part. Here is Guypen going up against Frisky Biscuits. Both teams operating at even strength, 3-on-3 in the pack. Both teams operating on braced two walls. Akers controlling the brace for Denver and Tarantula controlling the brace, still Guypen split it up for Rose City. and Guypin bowls over Tarantula in the process. Lead jammer status going to Denver. Guypin with a big smile on her face, being able to escape that.
I just feel like Rose City's triangles aren't as fluid as they need to be to contain somebody like Guypin. Having said that, Guypin picks up a forearms penalty and will go and sit in the box for 30 seconds.
Frisky Biscuits connected with Goings, but not enough impact to declare it a back block. So this goes, as Beatrix mentioned, the full 2 minutes. Frisky Biscuits is on a scoring pass. Akers with a big shutdown right there, moving Frisky Biscuits to the outside, now recycling all the way back. And I like what Frisky Biscuits did there, moving back to create a little bit of momentum.
Well, she needed it because Akers truly was taking all the space that Frisky Biscuits wanted and needed. And that's a testament to Akers. We see this all the time. Whenever she's on track, she's everywhere where the opposing jammer wants to be.
The lane got opened up by Chestnut here as Frisky Biscuits with one blocker to beat in the front in Goings. Able to do so is Guypin, now back in. And a blocking out of bounds penalty called on Tarantula is going to send her to the box. Guypin coming back in as Frisky Biscuits starting her second scoring pass. Rose City with one blocker on a disadvantage here. 4-on-3 in the pack, and that's working out in Denver's favor now as they've trapped Frisky Biscuits. But Akers having to bridge back to keep the front of her pack in play.
I'm kind of feeling like these packs are like accordions because they come so tightly together at times. In turn four, it's just a jumble of bodies and then stretch right the way out depending on who's pulling forward, of course.
Well, at least you didn't say they're annoying unless Weird Al Yankovic is playing them. So that means we're going to go into the half here waiting for full clarification on the points. Looks like we've got it 129-67 is the score. Rose City has taken advantage of those multiple scoring pass jams. Really a huge advantage in this game to Rose City.
Yeah, absolutely. But Denver picking up lead 13 times in that first half against Rose's 8. But Denver lost lead 3 times as opposed to Rose's 1. And when we look at jammer penalties, Rose jammers on 4 penalties, Denver jammers 5 penalties.
And that's really been the story because once Denver gets those jammer penalties, Rose City has shown they're capable of putting up at least 2 scoring passes and spread this lead out even further.
Yeah, and also the fact that Rose's blockers are able to shut down and really put Denver under pressure so that they're not able or they don't feel able to be able to do those multiple scoring passes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and take a little bit of a break. We've got about 13 and a half minutes left to go in the halftime, so we're going to step away. We'll be right back in just a few moments. Hello and welcome back to the conclusion of our coverage of the 2016 International Division I playoffs here in Columbia, South Carolina. You are watching Rose City versus Denver to determine who will get a first round bye at Champs as well as get some fancy schmancy gold medals.
Oh, I like a bit of fancy schmancy gold medals. Of course, this is the 2016 WFTDA Division I International Playoffs in Columbia, South Carolina, and the final game of the final day. We've seen some amazing roller derby already this weekend. This game, of course, not disappointing us. Nobody thought it would, right?
No, I came in expecting a great game here. And by the way, for those of you who don't know who we are, I'm Sasha Kim, deal with it, Morgan. This is Beatrix. How did I mess up your name this early, this late in the game?
That's it. I'm done. Game of playing
home. Come back to me. Come back to me. I'm sorry. So
that's it. It's over.
So looking at the first half, Denver actually had control of the lead jammer statuses. Multiple lead jammer going to them. But they lost a lot of leads. And when Rose City had lead, or even when they didn't, putting up multiple scoring passes, significant amounts of time.
Yeah, absolutely. And what Denver really needs to do is translate those lead jammer statuses into points, which isn't as easy. Of course, Denver total penalties at the moment 17, Rose total penalties 20. Now, 2 of those are for Scald Eagle.
Yeah.
And so we're wondering, could that become a problem later on in this second half?
You know, it's entirely possible. But then again, we're looking at Quigley, who had 4 going into jam, well, coming out of jam number 13, and has been back out there multiple times, has not committed a penalty since then. So sometimes you just need a moment or two to sort of collect your thoughts, take a deep breath, you know?
That's how I live my life. Denver picked up lead Gemma 13 times in the first half. Rose on 8. Denver losing that lead 3 times to Rose's 1. And when we talk about those jammer penalties, once again, Denver's jammers with 5 penalties between them, Rose with 4 between them.
And when we look at the blockers specifically that are causing most of the damage for each team, Jessica Chestnut for Rose City is sitting on 3. Gaither is sitting on 3. Nesbitt Smith is sitting on 3. Revis with 1. Tarantula with 2. Hannah Jennings with zip.
Which is absolutely amazing when you consider the work that's going on out there. Yep. But for Denver...
Wait.
Go on.
Braun Swanson also on zip. I don't know how I missed that one.
Because Braun Swanson, that's
tremendous.
All you have to say.
But yeah, and as you were saying about Denver.
Oh yeah, Davidson, of course, one of those game-changer skaters, one of the game-changer blockers for Denver Roller Derby, only on 2 penalties.
Mm-hmm.
Angle on 2 as well. Barrett, who seems to work quite a lot in tandem with Davidson, also on 2 penalties. But right now we're back to the action.
Well, the other important thing, Akers, the swing player who goes back and forth between offense so frequently, only on 1.
Akers is actually a pendulum.
Here we go, back in action is Wilhelm jamming against Lauren Much, coming off of the fast girl skate start line. Nesbitt Smith creating a bit of a lane blockage on the outside as Wilhelm is going to go to the penalty box for a track cut, and we're also going to see a track cut for Lauren Much. So both jammers rushing to the box. If they sit at the same time, they're going to serve 10 seconds.
Well,
they did not sit at the same time.
I wonder if they just had that little chat on the way there. Let's not do that.
let's absolutely not join at the same time. So about a 1 second difference between the two. They're both back out. Both are still going to need to complete their initial pass, which Much has just done.
And, you know, two of those game changers, Akers and Sarah Gaither, both going head-to-head. Sarah Gaither wanting to get Much out, Akers looking to shut her down, which she wasn't able to do the first time, but was certainly able to do it the second time as Much came in for a scoring pass.
And Garten trying to shut down Much here. Wilhelm has completed the first initial, as Much being recycled, still on her first scoring pass. 54 seconds left to go in the jam here as Wilhelm coming around on the outside lane, trying to get past a down Tarantula, but Tarantula right back up and blocking the lane here, and now recycling back with Braun Swanson joining in the process. And now both jammers being recycled as we are going in the wrong direction, everybody. This is not how this isn't the direction you go. I mean, obviously, if you're recycling, are we trying to rewind this jam?
Everybody's recycling here. And it's kind of frustrating to see one way, but it's great in another, you know, like...
Tremendous defense, absolutely.
Yes. You stole the words right out of my mouth.
I didn't mean to, I'm sorry.
It's fine. We weren't kissing, though, just...
There we go. That's probably for the best here. We got to finish this game. Here we go.
I'm sorry, everybody.
Lauren Much, with a twist through, she will pick up 4 points. And we'll see how much Wilhelm got, I believe also 4. So, quick correction there, Rose City with 5, Denver with 4.
Yeah, 1-3-4 plays 71. And time to mention S1 Pro knee pads. Stability, function, durability, and superior shock absorption makes the S1 Pro knee pad built for roller derby. Check out s1helmets.com.
Scald Eagle coming up to the fast girl skate start line, going up against Klein, both teams operating at full strength. As Scald Eagle trying to work her way on the inside lane, creates her own space, getting lead jammer status, as Angel on her way to the box as well for a multiplayer block. Klein trying to work her way around the outside, gets stuffed on the outside lane as Scald Eagle working her way through, mohawking, and now backwards through completion of the pass, and a track cut penalty to Klein. This is a power jam for Rose.
Scald Eagle actually running into her own defense of Jess Reavers on that initial pass. Just slowed her down slightly, but of course doesn't make a lot of difference right now because, as you say, Klein sitting in that penalty
and
box.
And it's going to send Scald Eagle to the box as well for a forearm penalty. So again, first 2 jams of the game, and we are seeing both jammers go to the box. We're both going to go for the full 2 minutes.
And Scald Eagle, 3rd penalty now already for her. Klein back on track and in play for Denver.
Rose City speeding up here is Denver looking to shut down the braced walls. Barrett trying to form a wedge to, as well as Angel on the outside trying to get a lane. Scald Eagle back in as the power jam is over. Klein.
Scald Eagle just literally skated with her legs open and Jess Reavers on the track. She skated over the top of her, not scrubbing off any speed whatsoever as she came out of that box and back onto the track, wanting to capitalize on that speed.
Klein still has to complete her initial. Scald Eagle on her second scoring pass. 22 seconds left to go as Denver with their brace now being maintained by S.H. Long, and they get declared out of play as S.H. Long and Goings have to let Scald Eagle go. 10 points in the jam so far for Rose City. Scald Eagle now coming in for her third, riding on the outside lane, getting chased by S.H. Long, not able to catch up, not even with a shove from Barrett to try and get S.H. Long to block out Scald Eagle. 15 points picked up by Rose City as they expand their lead.
Sasha, Denver kind of painted themselves into a corner a little bit because they had a three brace, but their fourth blocker was at the back trying to spring their jammer from behind the Rose City defenses. And when it came to stretching out and bridging that pack, there wasn't enough of them there to be able to hold Rose City at bay. 149-71, 25 minutes left.
And it's Licker and Split now jamming for Rose City, going up against Guypen. Guypen trying to take the inside lane, gets shut down for a brief moment by Baron Swanson, who takes her all the way to the outside, and that allows number 26, Gaither, to create just a little bit of a distraction, but Guypen survives it. She is out for lead as the star has been stashed by Licker and Split, trying to work her way through. Guypen now in the pack on her first scoring pass. Braun Swanson trying to stay in bounds on one toe stop as Guypen calls off the jam very quickly there as Licker and Split approached.
Yeah, Licker and Split a little bit like a bowling ball, just splitting the pins of Denver. All the blockers on the floor towards the end of that jam. Well, you know, Powerdyne's cutting edge designs, cutting edge performance. Performance plates for the modern derby game. It's Powerdyne.
Next jam lined up here. Both teams still operating at full strength. It will be Frisky Biscuits for Rose City going up against Curtis for Denver, who's backed herself up a little bit. If you're just joining us, Rose City in the purple, Denver in the white, as Frisky Biscuits trying to get around the braced two wall. Now trying to force the split up in the middle here between S.H. Long and Barrett. Meanwhile, Curtis working her way into the inside, Quigley jumping up to the front along with Chestnut to try and hold things back as Goings on her way to the penalty box for Denver. That's going to be a forearm penalty for her. Hannah Jennings coming up to play offense for Frisky Biscuits. She may have to drop back here in just a brief moment to bridge back and keep her pack in play. She does so as Chestnut able to send Curtis all the way to the back. 45 seconds in, still no lead as Frisky Biscuits has one blocker to beat, and S.H. Long is able to do so. Lead jammer status going to Rose City.
Yeah, patience, Padawan pays off absolutely for Frisky Biscuits there. Taking that time to get through, push until Denver's blockers were out of play, and, you know, get through obviously without picking up penalties, which is the aim.
Frisky Biscuits running into the wall here of Denver. Hannah Jennings tried to break it up a little bit and then had to jump back to bridge. Now is deciding to go ahead and let Frisky Biscuits split that wall out as Goings is going, that's easy to say, back to the penalty box.
But Denver, once again, with that short three wall up front and one of their blockers behind the Rose City pack, means that when it's time to bridge, they do fall short, and that's just,
a hit by Quigley that was a low block that could have been seen from space. She is going to the penalty box, and that is going to be a call off. 5 points picked up by Rose City.
Yeah, NASA totally just tweeted in using the hashtag talk the number 2 WFTDA live to say that they did indeed see that hit by Quigley, and that puts her on 5 penalties right now.
Whew. And she's a major part of that Rose City blocking strategy here.
Rose City 154, Denver 74, 21 minutes left of this second half, the final game here today.
As Willem jamming against Lauren Much. Lauren Much had a huge lane to get through as both teams missing blockers. Sarah Gaither able to restrain Willem for just a brief moment as we have a downed blocker. Denver has an injured blocker on the track here. This will freeze the clock at 21 minutes and 36 seconds as the EMTs right out to attend to the injured Denver blocker. And coming right back up is Garten. She is going to be moved to the EMT station here. So that freezes at jam number five. Here we see a shot of the penalty box here. As you can see, 82, that's Quigley for Rose on five. Jessica Chestnut and Sarah Gaither both with four. And on the Denver side, the blocker in the most trouble is Goings with three clockwises and a forearm.
Yep, so not so much pressure, I don't think, on the Denver blockers for the penalties. Oh, just checking that. No. Angle with three. Game changer. Mm-hmm. Barrett with two, and also Davidson still holding it too, but we're back to the action right now.
And that is Guypin jamming against Licker and Split. Two Rose City blockers on the track going up against three Denver blockers as Guypin cuts the track in the process. She is on her way to the penalty box. Huge opportunity as Licker and Split is passing the star to Tarantula. There will be no lead jammer here. Tarantula now The jammer for Rose, I believe. No. Wait a minute. Tarantula has been whistled out for a multiplayer block, and I believe an insubordination was also given. And the helmet cover dropped back, so the star pass was not complete. Licker and Split is back to being the jammer, and I believe still eligible for lead because she put the helmet cover back on. And Licker and Split will get through. She will not get that lead jammer status.
So this jam will go for the full 2 minutes, and Guypin coming out of that penalty box right now to get back on track and in play for Denver.
So both jammers back out there. Guypin will complete the initial pass once again. Licker and Split on her first scoring pass, trying to work through the inside lane, got shut down by Angel as Quigley going back to the box for her sixth penalty for a direction of gameplay penalty. Licker and Split found a huge lane on the outside. That's going to be 5 points picked up here for Rose City. Guypin on one skate trying to get through on the inside, trying to work her way through and past. Able to get past Rivas. So that's a completion of the first scoring pass for Guypin.
Yeah, and I feel like Denver Block is just playing it cool out on track, keeping that triangle formation strong, focusing completely on Licker and Split, not allowing themselves to be distracted. Although there, of course, Licker and Split does get through the pack, picks up 4 points for Rose City.
So Tarantula back out on the track after serving the two penalties, one for an elbow and one for an insubordination, which I believe occurred when she thought she had the star and became the jammer. As the jam times out here, 11 to 8 in that jam in favor of Rose.
If you're looking for better edging and stops, try the new Radar Halo Wheel, world-class edging without sacrificing grip. And we would like to give a big shout out to Radar Wheels. Thank you for supporting the WFTDA tournament.
So about 19 minutes and 10 seconds left to go here in the game, 168 to 82 in favor of Rose City, as we are going to take a brief official timeout because there was an NSO not in position.
Yep.
So we're going to come right back. A very quick official timeout here. Yeah, the penalty wrangler wasn't in place, so that's a problem.
Here, that's going to stop you.
As Scald Eagle jamming out there for Rose City, able to get through and lead. Klein with the helmet cover removed. She is the jammer, but stash the star. Barrett trying to create a little bit of space, and Scald Eagle just blitz right through, hopped over, and gets through. And Akers is now going to the penalty box for Denver.
I kind of feel like Klein is just burrowing away at that three wall at the back built by Rose City and not getting very far. Still stuck between jam line and pivot line, not able to break out. Thankfully, her teammate's coming in now to try and clear a space for her, but Scald Eagle already on another scoring pass.
Good sweep there by Denver to try and constrain Scald Eagle, but Scald Eagle able to get free. 15 points picked up. Klein still trying to work her way through, getting recycled back by Envy Adams. Scald Eagle approaching the Denver inverted brace Envy Adams breaking that up, trying to split SH Long apart from Barrett, as well as Davidson. And now Star has been passed to Akers, who has completed a penalty and completed the first scoring pass. Scald Eagle is through, and Akers coming straight through. That is a 5-point, a 4-point pass. So Scald Eagle letting this one continue as Akers, you don't see it on the screen, she's back in picking up her second scoring pass. Scald Eagle on her fifth, 27 seconds left to go here, as Akers, working her way through, gets knocked to the outside there by Sarah Gaither.
And Scald Eagle picking up a further 4 points for Rose City, checks in with the bench. Bench tell her to keep on going, keep on skating, and that's what she's going to do. But Denver resetting their defenses against Scald Eagle now to try and slow down, recycle, or just stop Scald Eagle.
Scald Eagle called off the jam there after picking up an additional 3 points, so a 27-8 jam in favor of Rose City, as Denver calls a team timeout.
They certainly do, and all our team timeouts sponsored by Atom Skates. Atom Skates have the colour Falcon plates and colour Q4 boots. Check out all the colourful new goods from Atom Skates, and also the new pilot plate in 7 stunning colours. You can do that by going to atomskates.com. So when we look there with jams with multiple scoring passes, Rose have 11. You know, and their score right now 195, and that last jam total, of course, being 27. Mm-hmm. Denver have 4 multiple scoring passes. Their score at 90, their last jam total staying at 8. So defensive work from Rose City against Denver, obviously very, very strong, like we said, putting that pressure on, not allowing them to feel comfortable to be able to complete more than 1, maybe 2 passes.
And clock frozen at 17 minutes and 5 seconds. If Denver wants to get back in this, they're going to need to bait Rose City's jammers into penalties, get power jams, and they're going to need to start baiting penalties on Rose City's blockers, and ideally try and foul out Quigley, Tarantula, Gaither, and Chestnut. Quigley's on 6. The rest of those are on 4. Then they are huge parts of that Rose City defense. As we're back in action now, Wilhelm, there's the first step in the direction for Denver to try and mount a comeback, as she is lead jammer for the Mile High Club. Frisky Biscuits trying to work her way through as she is essentially running into the entire Denver defense and able to break apart that braced wall. Now Wilhelm coming in, passing the hips of Rivas and calling off the jam. Rivas helping her up as Denver will pick up 2.
Yeah, Denver's jammer just actually having to do that turn and roll that we've seen quite a lot this weekend to try and test that defensive wall, mm-hmm. find the gaps, find the spaces, because they can be there occasionally. Didn't work out, and she was right to call off that jam and not give away any points to Rose City, having picked up 2 for Denver. No jammer has better than a 50% lead status right now, except for Frisky Biscuits, who's sitting on 50%.
So now Lauren Much going up against Guypen off the Fast Girls Skate start line. Both teams operating at full strength here, as Guypen has a chance at an inside lane. Gaither tried to shut it down, but Guypen survived. Lead jammer status going to Denver, as Lauren Much being recycled all the way to the back. Akers is on her way to the penalty box. So they're going to lose, Denver losing their pivot to a forearm penalty as Guypen completes the scoring pass. 4 points picked up and jam called off.
And Guypen equaling that lead rate as well now at 50% for Denver. I do like the way Guypen plays. She does look for her defense. She does look for her blockers from Denver, but equally very comfortable at making those spaces herself.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely true there, Beatrix.
I only speak the truth, Sasha. Come on now.
I wasn't doubting you.
I'm going to tell you quickly about Spank Alley, makers of awesome armbands, helmet covers, compression pants, and more. Check them out, spankalley.com.au.
Curtis now jamming against Liquor and Split here, as Hannah Jennings coming up to play a little bit of offense for Liquor and Split. And Liquor and Split able to pry open that 2-wall. Lead jammer status going to Rose City. Tarantula with a big hit there on Curtis, trying to keep her trapped in the pack as Liquor and Split taking the outside lane. Angel trying to hold her down, not able to do so as Liquor and Split will make this a 200-point game for Rose City. 200-96 right now. Jam still ongoing as Curtis has removed the helmet cover. Liquor and Split coming to the outside lane, having to reset to the inside now. Curtis coming behind her and getting shut down by Tarantula.
I don't know if you saw, Curtis went for a little jump just at the edge of the apex onto the straightway to try and move around Rose City's defenses, but it was 415 Jennings who was there to just pick her up as she came on in and knock her out and force that recycle back.
So SH Long now recycling Liquor and Split all the way back as Curtis, one blocker to beat, hops her way through. That's a completion of the initial as Liquor and Split taking a little bit of time to kill some clock as well as see if she can get past some blockers, but calling off the jam just as Curtis was approaching. Additional 5 points picked up.
Yep, so 2:05 now for Rose City. Plays Denver's 96, 13 and a half minutes left. Jessica Chestnut sitting in the penalty box for Rose, taking her up to 5 penalties. And thinking about penalties, total penalties so far in this game, Rose 30, Denver 27. And when we look at the lead jammer penalties once again, how many times lead jammers happened in this period? 3 for Denver, but 5 for Rose.
And that's really where Rose has been controlling the pace of the game, especially when they have multiple scoring passes like they seem to have almost every single time they get lead. Here is Frisky Biscuits now jamming against Wilhelm as Akers having to bridge back to keep the front part of her pack in play. Frisky Biscuits trying to push the braced wall here as Wilhelm also trying to work her way through, trying to get past Nesbitt Smith and Gaither.
I mean, this must feel like trying to push concrete balls up a hill.
Very Sisyphean effort here by Wilhelm thus far as her defense coming back to try and assist after Frisky Biscuits getting the lead jammer status. Now Frisky Biscuits has got the lap point on her first scoring pass. High impact hug there, trying to restrain Frisky Biscuits by Thorns, not able to get her reset on the brace as Akers again has bridged back, as has Chestnut, to keep the Rose City pack in play.
Yeah, and that bridging stretching all the way around from corner one into corner two. So amazing that you can fill nearly what, quarter of a track full of a bridge with just one pack.
Frisky Biscuits trying to get past one blocker here as, again, still maneuvering Frisky Biscuits through. Wilhelm has removed the helmet cover. Looked like she tried to get it to Akers and then got shut down by Nesbitt Smith and Gaither. Frisky Biscuits now starting her second scoring pass, working her way around. And a penalty called on Thorns for out-of-play engagement as Frisky Biscuits recycled to the back. Wilhelm still trying to work her way through. Frisky Biscuits completing the scoring pass. A star still stashed here for Wilhelm.
And just a moment in lapsing concentration there by the Denver blockers allowed Frisky Biscuits easy passage on the inside line. She came in once again for another scoring pass, picks up 13 points along the way, holding Denver at 0, 218-96.
It was interesting that Wilhelm got sort of pushed into the wall to try and stop Frisky Biscuits. Yep. Towards the end of that jam there, it's like, you're not getting through, just help us prevent points from being scored.
Become the fifth blocker. Okay, the WFTDA would like to thank our wonderful host, Columbia Quad Squad, 515 Magazine, Derby Central, Rollercon, Spank Alley, Kaya, and S1.
Skull Eagle now jamming up against Guypen. 10:45 left to go in the game as we're in jam number 12 of the second half. Guypen getting recycled back by the Rose City defense. Now braced wall is Revis and Hannah Jennings being braced by Tarantula. Scald Eagle getting knocked to the outside, and Scald Eagle for a misconduct is going to go to the penalty box. That is going to be her fourth penalty.
Well, you know, we did postulate earlier on in the first half when she already picked up two. Is this going to become a problem later on? Four penalties for a jammer, not great. 10 minutes left though, and Rose City do have a deep enough rotation that it could be okay.
No, Rose City not only has a deep enough rotation, but they've got fantastic defense that have been able to hold Guypen back for a significant period of time, but Guypen now on a scoring pass. Guypin trying to work her way around the outside, then get moved to the in. Now is Hannah Jennings starting to form that brace. Working with Chestnut as well as Rivas. Guypin trying to split apart, but straddled the line and got the cut in the process and is going to miss the point of no return. She's got to make the entire lap all the way through once again. Scald Eagle is back and completed the initial. Scald Eagle takes flight. Apex Jump gets 5 points for Rose City. I've been waiting for a while to say Scald Eagle takes flight.
Were you saving it? I'm sorry. I didn't recognize it.
I have to do one flight-based joke whenever a jammer is named after a bird in the game. It just has to happen here. Scald Eagle with an additional 5 points. 10 on the jam so far. 7 seconds left to go. Scald Eagle looking to complete. Went to try and call it off and then goes, oh yeah, right, I forgot, I'm not the lead.
But I'm always lead. Good job, ref. Guypin sat with 4 penalties, by the way, right now. So exactly the same as Scald Eagle as we go into a Atom Skate sponsored timeout for Denver. They've just hit the 100 mark, and I'm going to tell you about the Color Falcon plates and Color Q4 boots. Check out all the colorful new goods from Atom Skate, as well as the new pilot plate in 7 stunning colors. Hashtag color me Atom, hashtag Atom Skate. Check them out at atomskates.com.
So that was Denver's second team timeout here. Rose City still has 2. Both teams still have their official review. I can't imagine Rose City is going to want to take a timeout at any point here in the next 8 minutes and 46 seconds.
Yeah, I don't think that's on their list of things to do today at all.
Well, their list of things to do will likely soon include watching Champs on Friday. If this lead holds, they will be doing just that after earning the first round bye and winning this tournament. But their blockers having some trouble on in terms of penalties here. You can see Chestnut and Quigley still with 6.
And Tarantula just trailing a little bit behind on 5.
Not exactly something you want to trail behind on.
No.
Ideally, you would rather not be have any of them.
No, but absolutely. So, it happens. You would like to be like Braun Swanson, who is on 0 penalties.
And Hannah Jennings also on 0, which is, again, amazing with the physical kind of gameplay that Rose City plays here. As Rose jam has started, Lauren Much out there going up against Guypin. Now Guypin out of the penalty box. Much pushes her way through, and lead jammer status going to Much, but Guypin took the same hole through. She's going to chase her down. Is Guypin as Much taking the time to bleed out a little bit of clock and get her team back out there. All 4 blockers now back on the track for Rose.
Yeah, and I have to say, Davidson, a blocker of note once again for Denver. Chased Lauren Much through the pack on that initial pass, was there to pick her up as she came in for that scoring pass, although shut down by one of Rose's blockers.
Watson Cirbo got a big hit there, but a no pass, no penalty, because Watson Cirbo went out as well. So Much completes the first scoring pass. Guypin is still on her first scoring pass. Rose City running this one.
Yeah, and Guypin must be thinking in the back of her head, you know, that she's got 4 penalties there on the board. So do you really want to play crazy, or do you want to play conservative and not risk anything?
Well, there's the jam call up there to melt an additional 30 seconds off the clock after a recycle there by Watson Cirbo and Garten.
So Denver picking up 4 points in total in that last jam, and Rose City on 8 taking the scores. Denver 104, Rose City 241, 7 minutes 17 seconds left. 888, new helmets that protect against rotational violence with MIPS, patented brain protection system. You can find out more about that at 888.com.
And Klein, not even 3 seconds in, burst through the inside lane, getting lead, and Licker and Split took the same lane through about a half track length away here. Klein with the opportunity to put some points on the board for Denver. Working her way on the inside lane, moving forward, gets clocked by Hannah Jennings. That forces the call off, but Licker and Split steals away 4 points to Denver's 3.
Hannah Jennings just has that ability to really think about what is the opposing jammer doing, where do I need to be, how do I need to set myself up to try and stop any passage coming, any points being scored.
And she also has this great ability to keep her skates moving in proper derby direction while blocking, facing the opposite direction and not getting those direction of gameplay penalties.
Obviously, this is her superpower. So on that fast girl skates line, it is number 20, Willem for Denver, facing up against Frisky Biscuits, number 1 for Rose City.
Frisky Biscuits trying to work away on the outside lane there, getting shut down by Davidson now. As Frisky Biscuits moves to the inside lane, Davidson trying to chase her down. Frisky Biscuits is lead.
And that is a 63% lead rate that Frisky Biscuits holds right now in this game.
Frisky Biscuits taking the outside, moving into the end, gets trapped up by Akers and cuts the track by entering in front of Akers in the process. Power Jam Denver, but Wilhelm has to get out and complete the initial pass.
She doesn't. One of those people she's got to get around is Braun Swanson, who from the moment that penalty was called just earmarked Willem and stayed with her as much as possible through that pack, looking to impede, looking to take space when possible.
So Wilhelm now trying to find any kind of passage, now looking to split a part of two wall here with the help of her teammates, finds the outside lane. She completes the initial. Penalty is over for Frisky Biscuits. You'll see her enter the screen here shortly as Davidson rejoining the action, and Braun Swanson laying out Angel to create a little bit of a lane that gets shut down by Davidson and Garten, and a track cut called on Frisky Biscuits. So another power jam here as Wilhelm approaching the back of the pack to start her second scoring pass. Frisky Biscuits sat down with about 25 seconds left on the clock, so the power jam will carry over unless Wilhelm is penalized. And a elbow penalty is going to send, I believe that is Nesbitt Smith, to the penalty box.
And I think that's her second trip this jam
It was a forearm, quick correction there. And jam comes to an end as Wilhelm slow to get back up. And we are stopping the clock here just to make sure everything's okay with Wilhelm. EMTs did come onto the track. And as you mentioned, Nesbitt Smith did pick up an additional penalty here. And it looks like Barrett is having a penalty removed from her lineup.
Which is always nice to have a penalty removed. Let's just check in with those. Jessica Chestnut still sitting at 6 penalties. Alicia Nesbitt Smith now on 5. Tarantula also on 5. Scald Eagle with the 4. And of course, Quigley at the bottom sitting on 6 for Rose.
So we're about to resume action here as Frisky Biscuits standing in the penalty box. 9-5 was the last jam for Denver here, as Curtis will be coming out to jam for the Mile High Club. 3:51 is where the clock is frozen, as penalty box manager coming back to get things ready. And jam started. Rose City forcing the pivot line start here, now trying to get to the front and race, as Curtis looking to move around Rivas.
You know, that pivot line start isn't always a bad thing if you can grab that speed and not have it scrubbed off as you come into the pack. Of course, Rose City set up for that and just put Curtis at almost at a standstill.
Yeah, especially when Frisky Biscuits only had about 5 seconds left in the penalty, so that could have killed a little bit of timeout and gotten it back out there.
Have you checked out who's pivot for Rose City right now?
I believe it's Scald Eagle.
I wonder what might happen there.
I'd imagine if there's a moment where you need to push the panic button, it's going to go to Scald Eagle. So Denver is going to need to do their best to try and make sure that Scald Eagle stays separated from Frisky Biscuits, especially if Curtis can split this pack out and get lead. Pack is stretched all the way from turn 2 to the middle of the straightaway between 4 and 1. Lots and lots of bridging there as Curtis finally gets through. Lead jammer status going to Curtis, and you're going to have to imagine the star pass coming from Frisky Biscuits to Scald Eagle. Denver splitting up the pivot from the jammer, trying to keep Scald Eagle apart. Scald Eagle able to get the helmet cover. Star pass completed. Curtis on her scoring pass. Scald Eagle has completed the initial, and Curtis will call off the jam.
And I think that completely answers the question you might have been having at home. Can you keep somebody like Scald Eagle away from Frisky Biscuits? The answer is no.
Well, because Scald Eagle has incredible reach out there on the track. She's the perfect jammer to send out there for Rose City with, in terms of being the pivot, because her height and her...
There's a wingspan.
You know, the wingspan. Hey, I see what you did
there. Did you see?
Yeah, the wingspan really helped out there.
250 plays 120, and we are in the final 2 minutes of this game.
About 2 seconds of a discrepancy between period clock and jam clock. That 2 seconds favoring the jam clock here. So if we go the full two, the game will end unless something weird happens with an official review. Klein with the opportunity to put Denver a little bit closer here as she gets lead. And waiting to see what happened here with Lauren Much. Is Lauren Much going to the penalty box for a forearm? So this is going to be a power jam for Denver. Denver with a huge opportunity here as Klein on her first scoring pass. Tarantula pushed Bron Swanson into Lauren Much, and Lauren Much survived the hit. Bron Swanson having to move all the way back here as Akers forcing the recycle.
Note to the work there, though, by Klein. She was pinballing around that initial pass. This time comes in, finds the smallest space up that inside line, takes it to pick up a further 5 points for Denver.
And 10 points in the jam so far here as... in the box, Lauren Much has stood up. Klein on the third scoring pass takes the outside lane. 5 additional points picked up here for Denver. Much will still be on the initial. She is about to come into the right side of your screen. And here comes Klein starting her fourth scoring pass.
Akers coming up to support Klein in that passage through the pack this time. Though Klein knocked to the inside, she's going to be recycled right the way back once again.
Klein working her way into the pack as Akers is, Davidson on her way to the penalty box. Davidson was called out for a misconduct as Much still trying to work her way through. Tarantula coming up to help as Klein being recycled back, as is Much. 2 seconds left to go in the game, 3 in the jam. I think we're going to time out here and end the game. Unofficial final. We're going to see 2 more points added on for Denver. Rose will not pick up a point. Again, unofficial final, Rose City 250, Denver 137. Waiting for clarification, and it is now a final. Rose City will get the first round bye in their own house at Champs. They are the winners of the International 2016 International Division I playoffs here in Columbia, South Carolina.
And as you said, what a great way to start that Champs weekend, being in your own bed, able to hydrate at your own kitchen, and really take that time to be able to check out the other team, see what's going on the Friday, look at strategies that are being played, and think about how you're going to change that up.
This is something else that's going to benefit Rose City, too, because Rose City is an absolutely massive league. A lot of leagues that are hosting, they may also be volunteering in terms of their charter team, simply because their leagues may only have about 30, 35 people in them. Columbia was around that size. So they had not only their charter team playing, but they also had a couple of them volunteering throughout the weekend. Rose City's charter isn't going to have to do that, I believe, because Rose City has such a huge support staff within their organization.
Which is absolutely amazing, isn't it, for roller derby?
It really is.
Let's talk a little bit about penalties in that game. Rose overall took 38 penalties to Denver's 34. And jammer penalties, Rose were on 10 as a total jammer rotation against Denver's 9. And then we look at the scoring passes and wonder, how did we get to this score? 250 for 137. Rose with 16 multiple scoring passes to Denver's 7.
Yeah, that was the big, big killer right there. Every time Rose had the opportunity to put additional scoring passes on the board and put additional points on the board, they took it. 16 jams with multiple scoring passes is an awful lot throughout the course of the game. And looking at the penalty structure once again, nobody fouled out, but I think special credit has to be given to Bron Swanson and Hannah Jennings, completely clean, as well as Envy Adams. All three of those blockers played an awful lot of jams, and they did not pick up a single penalty.
I'm sure there's a special award somewhere for that, for having a completely clean.
And on the other side, Garten also completely clean. She was in an awful lot of jams as well.
So let's look at some of the jammer stats whilst we're here. Frisky Biscuits, 44% lead throughout the game. Liquor and Split on 22, Lauren Mutch 36, mm-hmm. and Scald Eagle on 33.
And then on the other side there, Curtis 38% lead, Guypen 40% lead, Klein 50, and Wilhelm 40. I don't think I've ever seen a game where no jammer has more than 50% lead. It's almost unfathomable, to be quite honest with you.
And Klein sort of kept at 50% because going into the second half, she was at 50%. Willem, for a while, was actually sitting at 60%. Yeah. That came on down as Rose's defenses ramped up the pressure in that second half. But on the Rose side, even at halftime, Mutch was at 33, Scald at 33, and Frisky Biscuits at 50. So not a massive amount of movement for Frisky Biscuits, just dropping down a little bit there.
What a game. What an incredible game. Well, folks, my name is Sasha Kim Deal with Morgan. This is the lovely Beatrix. Thank you so much for watching our tournament, but stay tuned. The medal ceremony and the Fast Girl Skates MVP will be coming soon. So stick around. We'll be right back.